revisit some of the people and places affected by the storm of 87.
Tuesday, the first of a two-part fairy tale.
The Hollywood fantasy to end all Hollywood fantasies.
The pressure of a life lived in the spotlight.
When I married, my private life became public.
The quest for love and splendid isolation. Grimaldi, Life with Grace, Tuesday, 10:40 on Meridian.
It's 8 o'clock on Friday, the 16th of October. Severe gales overnight have wreaked havoc over southern Britain. Four people have been killed. There have been extensive power failures. Most train services have been cancelled. Major roads are blocked and many buildings have been badly damaged.
Let us pray. O God our Father, as children of Holy Cross School, we come to our Church of Holy Cross for keeping us safe during the great hurricane.
When I arrived on the scene at 7 o'clock in the morning, there was just two policemen and a caretaker on the premises, and my first words to them were, thank God the children weren't here. We would have been holding mass funerals in Uckfield the week after. No way could they have all escaped. No way.
Well, 10 years on, Holy Cross School here at Uckfield in Sussex has been rebuilt. And many of the children here now weren't even born when the great storm struck. But in the next half hour, we'll be revisiting many of the people who were caught up in the drama of October the 15th and 16th. And we'll be looking at some of the issues that remain a decade on. 8 weeks before the great storm, Patricia Hayes and her husband retired from London to Kent. They called their new home Stormguard after the pedigree name of the German shepherds they used to breed for a living. It was to prove very appropriate.
We stood here by these patio doors, and we'd not long had a conservatory built that was backing onto it. And just by the light of the torches, you could see that the walls were shaking, the roof was going up and down, the doors going backwards and forwards. And then Ken put the torch over onto the greenhouse, and the greenhouse roof was going up and down like the Big Dipper at Margate.
I've heard bombing and fires and God knows what during the war, but I've never heard such a roaring noise.
A cold hand grips your heart and you think, oh my God. And I sat here and I thought, how do I tell him that the house isn't insured?
By midnight, the storm born in the Bay of Biscay was up to 80 miles an hour. From 2 a.m. to 9 a.m. it rampaged across the south, gusting at up to 114 miles an hour.
I remember calling it a right little hooligan. It was a unique little feature. It developed very quickly on the south and southeast side of it. It produced severe gales. But the really significant thing was that having produced these gales so they blew the trees from the sort of southeast towards the northwest throughout the night, and all the trees were in full canopy, they still had all their leaves, the ground was very soft from all the rain, as that little centre whistled past, the wind veered round to the west and immediately all these trees were banged over. And if you look back at pictures, you'll see just about every tree has fallen from sort of southwest to northeast.
After a night out at the pub, Bob Ogley, the editor of the Seven Oaks Chronicle, walked home across the highest point in Kent, Toys Hill. 6 hours later, people looked on in disbelief. The woodland had been flattened. There were awesome new horizons. You could see all the way from Toys Hill to the Ashdown Forest.
I remember thinking, how many people have died? It's a day I'm not looking forward to. It's going to be horrific. And my fears were confounded when I saw a tree on a house, and nobody in that room, in that particular room in the middle, it was obviously a bedroom. No one could have lived with that tree as it was. And it was only later that I discovered that the father of that family, in the middle of the night, suddenly decided to evacuate, and he took his wife and three children into a field, and they sat huddled together with this hurricane for company. No telephone. Every single road in and out of the town blocked by fallen trees and newspaper to produce. So we decided to hire an aeroplane. And I had a photographer in that aeroplane who took these incredible photographs, dramatic pictures of this area, of Knoll Park, of Toys Hill Woodland, over Tunbridge, over Seven Oaks. We flew towards Maidstone as well, and we could see the floods down below and all these trees all on top of each other down below. And the picture he took of the Seven Oaks, six of them down, was a kind of piece of instant history. Seven Oaks had lost its name.
10 years on, there are eight oaks, the sole survivor, and seven younger trees. Highcliffe, Dorset. No one enjoys the view across to the Needles more than the pensioners who live in retirement flats a short walk from the sea. Many, like Dick Cooper, came here with wartime memories. They thought they'd seen their last air raid, but they were wrong.
It was 2:20 in the morning. We had a big crash, and it had arrived, as far as I was concerned anyway, and the window came in on top of the wife, and it all went on from there. The two blocks on this road had the roof completely off and on the ground, and the Penelope Court where I live was rolled back like a sardine tin. The roof was still on the back half of the flats, but not the front. To see what we had here, the state that the place was in, and to say there was no injury was a miracle. No other word for it, it was a miracle.
But no one needed a miracle more that night than the captain of the Hengist. In Folkestone Harbour, his crew were woken by the sound of mooring ropes snapping in force 12 winds. Fearing the boat would be dashed against the harbour wall, the captain headed for the channel. But a mile from harbour, the engines failed.
The seamen and people were securing the ship and battening down what they could on the bridge with the wireless officer and myself. We possibly had more time to sit and ponder our situation. And yes, I honestly thought the thing was going to go over, because I've never been on a ship which has rolled so violently in my life.
The ferry ran aground on a stretch of level beach, anchored by a concrete jetty which pierced the hull.
It was an excellent place to end up, because we were pinned on the corner, as I say, with this concrete sticking inside us for 30-odd feet. Then there was nowhere to go. Afterwards, of course, we could get onto the apron to get off when the ship settled, and we all walked away in one piece, thank goodness.
The Isle of Wight had been the first place hit by hurricane force winds. Gusts of over 110 miles an hour and mountainous seas swept away a treasured landmark.
I switched the radio on and they were saying about all the damage in the south, and then they said, and on the Isle of Wight, Shanklin no longer has a pier. I just couldn't believe it. We came over, and when we turned that corner, the sight was unbelievable. There were huge piles of wood, parts of the building, the dome of the old, lovely old theatre was out on the shoreline across here, and it was just complete devastation. It was dreadful.
The gusts that had roared across the Isle of Wight brought tragedy as they hit the mainland at Christchurch. Two firefighters were killed when a falling tree crushed their cab. They received posthumous bravery awards. They called it the Big Bad Wolf. Pam Hubbard was in charge of Kent Fire Brigade's Red Watch the night it huffed and puffed and blew the south down.
I walked into the control room and said to my deputy, who was in charge at the time, has it been quiet? And she said, yes, but I don't like the sound of this wind. And at that moment, the curtains behind me that you can see just blew straight out, and the wind blew straight into the control room. Almost at exactly the same time, every fire line in the control room lit up, and they stayed like that for, I would estimate, the next 8 to 10 hours.
Off-duty firefighters were called in, and one radioed the control room to say he'd just been passed by a shed on the Thanet Way. One of the 999 calls on that night came from a seafront tower block.
She was sitting in her bathroom and felt as though she'd got vertigo, and she felt as though her bathroom was moving. We sent a pump along to her, and it turned out she was on the top floor of a block of flats at Margate, and the block of flats were actually swaying in the wind.
Another call was to Beacon Hill Farm at Biddenden. A new house now stands where a chimney crashed through the roof and into an upstairs bedroom.
We moved the rubble as far as we were able to, and we'd got it down to about 3 feet in depth when the first pump, Tenterton, had arrived. They had spent over an hour cutting their way through fallen trees to reach us. I set that crew to work, continuing what we had been doing, and Benny and I had went downstairs into the kitchen and tried to cut our way through the ceiling into the bedroom from that direction. I eventually got a message from the crew upstairs that they had found the casualty. I went up and checked it for signs of life, but it was obvious that it was fatal.
Only when the sun came up was the scale of devastation revealed. How the mighty had fallen. Southern England would never be the same again.
About 5, 6 in the morning, woke up, not through the storm, but Labour was really quite strong then, and it was about that time that I thought that I needed to perhaps make a move to hospital, not thinking that that wouldn't be possible.
Mrs. Esposito was going nowhere. All 5 routes out of Ardingly were blocked by fallen trees. The ambulance service tried to get through, but there's no holding nature, and Danny was born at home.
He's a lively, independent young boy. I don't know whether it's got anything to do with being born with the wind at his heels, but he certainly runs very fast, and maybe he's got a career for that in the future. But he's a delightful, one of my 3 delightful young sons. Yeah.
Now this is a machine that could blow out a few candles. This is the R.J. Mitchell Wind Tunnel at the University of Southampton. It's the finest wind tunnel in the region. Usually it's used for scientific research. But today we've borrowed it to find out what the great storm was really like. If you were turning in at about midnight, you would have experienced this kind of speed of wind, about 30 or 40 miles an hour. But later on, things got dramatically worse. At Shoreham in Sussex, the maximum wind speed was about 115 miles an hour, and that's the maximum this wind tunnel can do. The question is, how much can the human body stand? Now this isn't the speed of the great storm, this is just half the speed of the great storm, 55 miles an hour, and as you can see it's like leaning against a brick wall. It's no wonder that 17 people were killed, 15 million trees were destroyed, and more than £1.5 billion worth of damage was caused. And if this had happened during the day at twice this speed, then surely hundreds or even thousands of people would have been killed. Well, after the storm came the questions. And the question that was asked more than any other was, why wasn't it forecast? More than 2,000 people work here at the Met Office at Bracknell in Berkshire. But it was one man who seemed to get the blame. And on the face of it, the prosecution's case was a strong one. Exhibit number 1.
Earlier on today, apparently, a woman rang the BBC and said she heard that there was a hurricane on the way. Well, if you're watching, don't worry, there isn't.
That's the clip we've all come to know and love. 10 years on, Fish is still fighting his corner. You can have the clip, he said, as long as you play it in full.
Earlier on today, apparently, a woman rang the BBC and said she heard that there was a hurricane on the way. Well, if you're watching, don't worry, there isn't. But having said that, actually, the weather will become very windy, but most of the strong winds, incidentally, will be down over Spain and across into France.
A defence of sorts, but the man himself admits he didn't know it was coming and for a while didn't realise it had come.
When I drove into work at 4 o'clock in the morning and I realised that the roads were a bit quiet,
and that everything was in darkness. I thought, my God, something must have happened. But it was only really when I got to work. No, it wasn't even when I got to work. It was several hours after I got to work that the real severity of the situation began to sink in. The original computer forecast predicted that the storm would pass more or less up the channel or just across the extreme southeast of England, whereas in fact it headed across to the north of London, and that was the big difference. But for a computer to be able to forecast accurately the track of a storm several days in advance really takes some doing, even now.
Andy points out that his forecast was 48 hours before the storm, and that he was off duty on the night in question.
It was Bill Giles that did the fateful forecast the evening before, when he talked about gentle breezes up the channel or something like that, but I got all the flack.
The failure to forecast struck at the heart of Met Office morale. A damage limitation exercise was launched. It seized upon a forecast a few days before the storm, which finished with the caption, "Becoming very windy late in the week." But the first warning of severe weather to the emergency services was issued at 1:20 on the night of the storm, and by then it was just minutes from the south coast. 10 years on, the tools the forecasters blamed have become more sophisticated. The Met Office has had three generations of supercomputers since the storm, and the latest can perform 300 million calculations a second. Forecasters believe it would have given 24 to 48 hours warning of the great storm. There have been big advances in satellite technology too. There are now other spies in the sky. 19 Boeings have been fitted with ASDAR, a system which feeds the Met Office weather readouts every 7 minutes.
Good afternoon. It's turned out to be a very pleasant morning. Yes, a fair amount of cloud round, but there's spells of hazy sunshine. Again, today the temperature...
The Meridian weather forecaster Carl Tyler was off duty the night before the storm. If he's on duty when the next one arrives, he's confident he and his colleagues will see it coming.
We've got some lovely stuff now. We've got floating buoys in the Bay of Biscay. We've got them in the channel. We've improved things tremendously. The radar improvement is fantastic now. We have radar covering the whole of England and down into France. We can spot storms developing. And not only that, the actual radar can then forecast 6 hours ahead and give us a tremendous idea of it. In fact, if you look at 1990, now we had storms in 1990. It was almost as bad. They went on for weeks. They were forecast probably 36, 48 hours ahead. Perfectly forecast. So I think today, if that sort of thing happened, you can't guarantee it. You can never guarantee anything with the weather, but I should think you'll be looking for at least a warning of 24, probably 48 hours of that type of thing happening.
The storm blew down a quarter of all the trees in southern England. At this park in Canterbury, art students were invited to work on some of the casualties. And as they started carving, politicians, landowners, and naturalists sharpened their knives for a debate that's still going on a decade later. The question is, were we right to clear away all the fallen trees, or would Mother Nature have done the job better? Were we, in effect, trying to play God and then getting it wrong? As the storm died down, the cry went up for action. The trees had fallen on our land. There was a national call to help clear up the mess. In the run-up to the Great Storm's 10th anniversary, the National Trust was keen to show off successful replanting programs. From the ground and from the air, cameras were invited to photograph flourishing young trees. But the cameras weren't invited to seal chart east of Sevenoaks. Naturalist Pete Rain says that what took place here is typical of what happened to far too much of the South's wild woodland.
All that we could think of doing collectively was clear up the mess and plant more trees. And bulldozers and JCBs went in, scraped off effectively the topsoil in which the seed bank was anyway, compacted the soil, which is particularly serious on thin soils like the ones we're standing on, and cleared away the mess very energetically, thereby producing an almost sterilised woodland, and then planted trees into this compacted soil, most of which have actually died. We imagined that the storm was going to wreck the woodlands, because we'd never heard of anything like it in our little human way. But woodlands have been around in Britain since the ice last went back 10,000 years ago. They've probably seen 15 or 20 storms of that intensity. They're quite used to dealing with it. We weren't giving the natural ecosystems enough credit to be able to cope with problems like this on their own.
I suppose in this little clearing here, there's about 200 trees. At a guess, about two of them are doing well, and at least half of them are dead, like this one here, dead waste of about £1.70's worth of tree and tube. And worse than that, the trees have come down, the bulldozers have gone in, and you can see the soil where I'm standing, it's just brown. There's nothing growing here in contrast to the areas that haven't been bulldozed, where there's a luxuriant growth of vegetation. So there's an oak there that's just at the top of the tube doing all right-ish. Beech there that's very dead. And, well, I don't even know what that is. It's just got dead leaves at the bottom. So basically, that's the problem. Money spent, effort spent, woodland compacted, trees dead. Not the right approach.
By contrast, Westfield Woods near Maidstone was declared a non-intervention zone. The mess was left alone, and the result, thriving new woodland. Bedgbury Forest on the Kent-Sussex border lost 40% of its trees in the storm. The devastation was tackled with a mix of replanting and non-intervention.
Of the 4,000 acres that were cleared, we've replanted about 2,200 acres with a mixture of conifers and broadleaf, and we left the remainder to regenerate naturally, and that's mostly birch, oak, chestnut. So we like to think we struck the right balance.
And at Bedgbury, there was another response to the storm. A storm guard was planted, a belt of fast-growing sturdy trees that slow down gusts of wind before they reach Bedgbury's Pinetum, Europe's most important collection of conifers. It was also a response to global warming and fears about climate change, fears that storms will become more frequent and more ferocious.
We're already starting to see the evidence. We've seen devastating floods in Central and Eastern Europe, which the Meteorological Office have actually linked publicly to global warming. We've seen torrential rain in June. The harvests have been damaged. We're seeing records being broken all the time as far as temperatures are concerned, and 1997 is on course to be one of the hottest on record. So something strange is happening to the weather, and I think a lot of people realise that.
People have been talking about this climate change. It's getting warmer. We're going to have a lack of water and all the rest of it. I've got a lovely book at home. It's Agricultural Records. It goes back to 220 AD. And in the 17th century, you could walk across the Thames at London Bridge and not get your knees wet. So it's all happened before.
The climate has changed in the past, but what we're seeing now is a rate of change that we've never experienced. It's a speed of temperature rise greater than has ever been seen in the last 10,000 years, which is essentially human history. And that means that everything's going to become a lot more unpredictable, a lot more extreme. Wildlife won't be able to adapt to it. Human society will have trouble adapting to it.
So what can we learn from the lessons of history? Well, this was how one man described the great storm. The bricks, the tiles, even the stones from the tops of the houses flew out with such force and were so thick in the street that no one thought fit to venture out, even though their houses were nearly demolished within. That was how the diarist Daniel Defoe described London the morning after the great storm of 1704, which killed 8,000 people. 283 years were to pass before England ever experienced anything like it again. The question is, how soon will the next big wind be? And how will people cope with it? Come to think of it, what will the weather be like on October the 15th, which is the 10th anniversary of the great storm? Well, the Met Office has stuck its neck out and said there won't be another hurricane. Touch wood.